Welcome you all in participating in this 18th lecture of the Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism. Before we start, let us request Buddha Master to lead us in making the following prayer.
Please follow me to recite the following text on the generation of Bodhicitta. Namo, in front of our root gurus, the masters of all masters, we pay homages to them all with no differences. In order that all sentient beings will be able to attain Buddhahood, may our minds in practicing the profound yogas be completely fulfilled. Now let us invite Vajra Master Pemal Hadran to enlighten us with teachings on the Buddhist Holy Dharma.
I am glad that you have come to the 19th lecture of the Essence on the Dharma Practice of Tibetan Buddhism. We have divided the contents of this whole series into two parts. The first part, from the 1st to 15th lectures, have explained the post-death world of experiences, and what we have to pay attention to when encountering those experiences of the post-death world. We have also mentioned some of the important points on one's Dharma practice. Starting from the 16th lecture onwards, we have talked about mind training. This is the second part. And this mind training episode has now come to the 4th lecture. And mind training is the most basic and important part of our Dharma practice. If you don't have this part, basically the many techniques that you have learned are of no use. You will not be able to succeed in your Dharma practice. Your final goal will not be achieved. And for mind training, there are some important points. There is a very important foundation that we need to know. That is, how can we develop some criteria for judgments and dealing with matters in relation to mind training? This is very important. And the first thing, we need to know how to distinguish between right and wrong. In our Dharma practice, many people do not value this thing, especially for those who practice tantrism. When one feels that one has acquired a lot of techniques and knows how to visualize, one will assume that one must be able to reach the Buddha's pure lands. Or for one who has read some sutras, the same happened to those who believe in Mahayana Buddhism, after one has read some sutras. And thinks that as long as one has made sufficient recitations of sutras or mantras, or has met certain requirements, one must be able to arrive at the Buddha's pure lands. However, one has not noticed that, in fact, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had expounded the sutras for 49 years. And that most of his teachings were to teach us how to distinguish between right and wrong. So, when the Lord Buddha felt that his disciples did not know how to distinguish between right and wrong, he had decided to set up the precepts so as to let them know more clearly as to how to distinguish between right and wrong. In other words, to know how to distinguish between right and wrong is, indeed, very important. For those people who had been deeply hypnotized, they have recalled their previous lives and found that there was a very important reason why they had to reincarnate after they died. According to what they have said, they were forced to return in reincarnations because of the fact that they had made either the same mistake or had made many different mistakes in their previous and or numerous lifetimes. In order to rectify those mistakes, they were thus forced to go for different reincarnations. They did not have any choices and were forced to reincarnate and to be reborn again. For those people who had this phenomenon and were thus able to describe this phenomenon, must have to accept a very deep level of hypnosis. This was not just being able to see one's previous life, but was also able to see the things that happened after one died and before one were to be reborn. That is, to be able to see things that happened during the transitional phase in between two lives. This is something that needs a very deep level of hypnosis in order for one to see. From those people who were able to recall their experiences, they all said that this was the most important reason why they had to reincarnate again. They also said that there was an elder, or a higher level spiritual person, who had communicated with them and let them know why they had to do so. The reason was that there were a lot of things that they had done wrong. It was necessary for them to come back and to redo and correct them all, in order to have the opportunity to stay in a better place for a bit longer, or to be promoted and to have a better reincarnation. So, if one wants to be elevated, one needs to be like this. This is just for those people with better karmas, and so they would have this kind of phenomenon. For those people with poor karmas, and who will be reborn in the three evil paths, there would not be a high-level spirituality to communicate with them. Despite the use of a very deep level of hypnosis, there was no such memory to be recalled, as there was no such part in their memories, simply because there had never been such a thing to have happened. Hence, for those people who had these deep-level memories and were able to tell something like these, they were supposedly to be pretty good actually. They may be able to be reborn into the three good paths, such as the human path, and thus they would have the opportunity to encounter such scenes. Therefore, in order to lead all of you to know more clearly about what is right and wrong, we have now quoted the very famous course from Professor Michael Sandel of the Harvard University of the United States. This course was even broadcasted on the television for the whole of America for the first time, and it was also uploaded onto the YouTube. This very famous course is known as Justice, What's the Right Thing to Do? And I have cited some of the cases from there in order to teach everyone to analyze what is right or wrong. Among the many people, there are those who have misunderstood that when we have a mind of compassion, or a good heart of kindness, and judge something as either right or wrong. Can one simply say that, for the sake of compassion, I can sacrifice a small number of people in order to save more people? And so, is this kind of criterion a correct one? In this course, known as Justice, What's the Right Thing to Do, this professor has cited a very famous case. This real case was talking about the lawsuit between the Queen of England and two common people. One was known as Dudley and the other one was known as Stevens. This was the real case which has been discussed in our last lecture. Let me briefly recap a little bit about it now. This case occurred on September 6, 1884. This Dudley was the captain, while Stevens was a crew member, and Brooks was a sailor. There was also a waiter by the name of Parker. This Parker was only 17 years old. He was an orphan, and it was the first time for him to go out to the sea. The boat that they were riding sank, and so the four of them took a lifeboat by the name of Mignonette. After drifting for more than 20 days, they were finally rescued by a German ship. The people who saved them at that time had described it as follows. There are four people on board. Among them, the dead body of Parker had almost no meat left, his blood had been drunk dry, and his flesh had been eaten. As they returned to the UK, and when their ship berthed, the three men were immediately arrested. At the time of their arrests, they were accused of committing murder. It was the Queen of England who filed a lawsuit against them. However, when the British government accused them of committing murder, the sentiment of the crowd was surging, and everyone sympathized with these three people. And these three people also thought that they were right, and it was necessary for them to kill this person, drank his blood, and ate his flesh, for the sake of maintaining their own lives. This was to sacrifice one person in order to save three people. If they used this criterion to make a judgment, it was nothing wrong with them morally. So, all of them did not admit that they were wrong. Hence, this lawsuit had to be continued. Here came the problem. In the reality of the Victorian era of the British society, all people had sympathized with these three people. And it would lead to riots if the judges at that time sentenced them to any relatively heavy penalties, such as life imprisonment. Why? Because during those days, all the people had to rely upon the sea as the main means of transportation. If, just in case, there was a law in laying out that the killing of people as a result of shipwrecking would commit a crime, they were afraid that, one day, they would face this situation and would commit crimes if they have killed other people under this kind of situation. In their minds, everyone was under the impression that they should be able to do this. All in all, to them, this criterion of killing one person to save some more people was a correct one. Thus, these people were under surging sentiments and had made an opposition to the government. They were standing up against the government's decision. This case is, indeed, really too special, or that the legal point of view thus aroused is so very special. That even up till now all the world-renowned law schools still used this classic case for debates and dialectic inquiry from some legal points of view. It's the same now, for all the legal practitioners to have trainings in the courts, one must have to know about this case. And so, why does this case attract so much attention from the public? Because at that time, the custom of the sea is a custom that is said to be practiced by the officers and crew of ships and boats in the open sea. Which means that every one of them was accustomed to so doing, in such a way that when a ship sinks, the survivors who were left behind could then draw lots as to decide who would be killed and be eaten after being killed, so that other people could continue to survive. This was later to be known as survival cannibalism. This was the custom of the sea at that time. On the other hand, the maritime law or admiralty law was the real body of law that governs nautical issues and private maritime disputes. In trying to outlaw that custom of the sea at that time, however, there was no way to start off in doing so. Then, this case came along and happened. So, there were some judges who hoped to take this case as an opportunity to amend the custom of the sea, such that it would finally be outlawed and replaced by the real maritime law. Therefore, this case became a must-win case for the British judiciary. The British judiciary must win this lawsuit. In case of losing this lawsuit, the custom of the sea would continue thereafter. What was the reason for finding it very difficult in pursuing this lawsuit? In fact, the defense lawyers pointed out that there was a similar case that had occurred in the United States 43 years ago. They had cited this case as a precedent. This case was the United States v. Holmes. That was the United States government had filed a lawsuit against Holmes. The incident took place in 1841 when a ship in the United States called William Brown sank after colliding with an iceberg. There was a crew member on the lifeboat by the name of Holmes. He thought that the lifeboat was overloaded, and he believed that if the overload continued, everyone on the lifeboat would die. So, he made a decision himself and personally pushed 14 to 16 people into the sea. The sea was very cold at the time, and so people would definitely die when they were pushed into the very cold water. As a result, all of them died. After 16 people were pushed to the sea and died, it was true that this boat was not overloaded and had smoothly returned to the shores of the United States. When Holmes returned to the United States, he was immediately arrested and charged with murder, but then later he was accused of manslaughter instead. It was mainly because the grand jury at that time refused to accept the original indictment, and so the verdict of this case was changed from murder to manslaughter for its final judgment. At the end, Holmes was only sentenced to 6 months in prison with a fine of $20. When this case was then cited in the British court, it was pointed out that the US case was a case of justifiable homicide or reasonable killing. So it could only be called manslaughter instead of murder, or that it even deserves a light sentence. Hence, all the public opinions were more sympathetic to them, feeling that there was no reason to impose heavy punishments on them by now. Because the group was too surging and indignant at the time, if the sentence was too heavy, it would trigger a mass demonstration. This situation had also proven that the social culture at that time was a kind of mentality in which the drinking of blood and the eating of raw flesh was acceptable. And thus eating human flesh and drinking human blood were to be considered of no problem. It was the mentality of the strong oppressing the weak, with the strong one or the lucky one who had not been picked up by drawing lots, then it would be okay. They extremely ignored morality and justice. That was to say, they felt that life was more important than the mind nature, or human moral standards, or a sense of justice. They felt that life was all the more important than anything else. Therefore, this group of judges wanted to elevate the evolution of human beings and its civilization. They wanted to elevate the entire human culture to a higher plane, so as not to stay in the era of drinking blood and eating raw flesh, while regarding life as the most important thing of all. So, they tried to use the law to outlaw this custom of the sea. Hence, this case became a must-win case for England during the Victorian era of that time. For the sake of winning this lawsuit, this group of judges had to look for some ways and means to do so. Because their opponents had cited such a strong case in point, and so they must have to figure out some solutions. There was a presiding officer in the district court by the name of Baron Huddleston. Therefore, he used a ploy to guide the jury in such a way by making them to believe that they themselves were ignorant. In doing so, by making them to believe that they themselves were ignorant and did not have the ability to make any judgment on the case, and thus voluntarily returned the power of the judgment to the judge. Because if it was a jury verdict, they would most likely sentence the accused to either manslaughter or innocence. Because the group sentiment was surging, and the jurors were just ordinary people with little legal knowledge, such that they would have very vague idea on the boundary of the so-called justice. And so if they were to make a verdict, they would definitely sentence them to sinlessness. In order to be able to refer the case to some knowledgeable and conscientious people for legal judgment, this judge used the ploy to guide the jury to confess that they were ignorant and thus gave up the jurisdiction of the case. As a result, the case proceeded smoothly and was thus transferred to the High Court for trial according to the judge's plan and arrangements. There was the Chief Justice, Lord Coleridge, in leading four other judges to form a panel of judges for the interrogations. While the Attorney General, known as Sir Henry James, was leading three other barristers outlaw together to fight for this lawsuit. At the time, the mainstream thinking was the practice of the custom of the sea, which did not attach any importance to either morality or to justice. This is what the Buddhist called as the collective karma. Collective karma means the collective behaviors of all people together, with their thoughts and behaviors to be of the same tendency. Collective karma is a very powerful force. Indeed, it is so very powerful and is very difficult to be changed. So, when a riot was aroused, there was no way to deal with it. The judges were only a small group of people. They tried to change the collective karma. So, what is the final result of this judgment? At that time, the crowd sentiment was surging and had advocated acquittal for the two defendants. Would this group of judges betray the law for this reason? And thus make a light sentence for those murderers, or simply judge them as innocent? In the end, can we use the law to set things right by clearing up all the confusions and rectifying all reversals of right and wrong? And thus successfully elevate the overall civilization progress of mankind? Can the judges strike a balance between society, on the one hand, and righteousness and justice on the other? What do we think about this in the Buddhist Holy Dharma? Can the Buddhist Holy Dharma explain these situations and whether it can conform to these complicated cases of our daily life? If we use the wisdom of the Buddhist Holy Dharma to resolve these right and wrong problems of our daily life, can we actually do it? Can we be able to explain them? Before we will try to explain these answers, we still need to observe one more thing. That is, will the Buddhist Holy Dharma be challenged by the results of reality? In fact, during their processes of Dharma practice, a lot of times many people do not know how to distinguish between right and wrong, and so they will feel very much confused and puzzled. For what has been said in the Buddhist scriptures, sometimes it seems to be quite correct and should be used. But, then, when it comes to its application, it seems to have no effects and thus cannot be done. Was it because I have misunderstood it? Or whether there is a mistake in the Buddhist Holy Dharma? Or whether in actuality, the Buddhist Holy Dharma cannot be applied at all in our everyday life? All of these questions are what we need to think about. Before I'll explain the correct answer, I have to ask you some questions first. On the issue, first of all, if you are the one in power, please note that the person in power refers to the person who has the power to decide upon the case, that is, you might be one of the members of the jury at that time, not necessarily the judge. In short, now you are the person in power, how would you judge? Will you pronounce a judgment with a sentence by taking a murder as a murder? If you think that you are a person of principle, you will think that a murder is a murder. You can't make a light sentence. You can't use some excuses so as to make a light sentence. So, you'll decide to sentence them of being guilty in committing a murder. If you think you will choose this answer, please raise your hand. There is more than a dozen of you. I have already said that you are persons of principle, and so you will think that a murder is a murder. There is no excuse. It must be sentenced like this. Now is the second answer, see if any one of you will choose this. If you are a utilitarianist, you will think that you must consider the interests of the public and the factors of social stability. We can't just blindly and inflexibly say that murder is murder, ignoring the situations at the time and making a judgment, resulting in the arousal of riots and even more casualties. Utilitarianists will consider everything. After considerations, it depends on which one is more beneficial, and then they will choose that one. Utilitarianists are like this. That is, they just cannot take into account those principles of moral standards or justice, and think that those are just dead stuffs. You will probably think that it will need to be a bit flexible, such that to sentence them as not guilty, or to close the case by just giving a light sentence. In order to avoid the phenomenon of social unrest. If you choose this answer, please raise your hand. There are three persons. So, you will find that those people who are Dharma practitioners, they are more prone to principlism. Those Dharma practitioners with inclination towards utilitarianism are comparatively less. We will all see such kind of phenomenon. Third, can we use wisdom to come up with a better solution in order to solve this contradiction? If you choose this answer, you will need to give us your plans or ideas. Is there anyone? Byron, can you try? Please give him the microphone. You choose this, use wisdom to come up with a solution, so what kind of wisdom can be used to solve such a complicated case?
In fact, I may not be able to come up with a perfect plan to solve this problem. I can only say that for the situation at the time, together with the thoughts of the judges, were to reverse the incident. This is, the incident on the custom of the sea was a big problem, and had affected the upholding of morality and justice at that time, and so they wanted to reverse the situation. I think that the method for the court judgment is to reverse the incident and sentence him to be guilty. But at the same time, there could be some leniency for the judgment making in not having pronounced such a heavy verdict, so that the sentiments of the surging crowd could be lowered. This may be a better method. But I have not figured out a very specific method yet. Thank you, Guru.
In fact, as a Buddhist, we must choose the third choice. We must not choose the first and second choices. Though, as the classmate have just said, I would like to choose the third choice, but I could not think up of a plan. While one cannot think up of a plan is one thing, but one's criterion of choosing the choice is of another thing altogether. Although I know that I am not capable of doing this, the direction from the nature of my mind directs me to choose the third choice. This is very important. In other words, I have to use wisdom to choose a better direction to solve these matters. Why do we have to choose the third choice? I will explain slowly as to why. In the Buddhist Dharma, it is not just a principlist, nor a utilitarian, but has to be a third type of person who can use wisdom. Wisdom is one of our six paramithas, one of the six important elements. Why did the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni focus so much on wisdom and to have included wisdom in the practice of six paramithas? It is because it is one of the most important elements that can help to take us to the other shore. If you do not have it, you just cannot get to the other shore. You simply cannot get out of the cycle of karmic reincarnations, and there are so many obstacles that are blocking you. So, this wisdom is, indeed, very important. I will now give the answer. On December 9, 1884, the Chief Justice Lord Coleridge proposed and said such words, "Where is the real crux of this case? It is necessary to clarify one thing on this matter: is this killing behavior to be considered as a kind of murder or not? In order to determine whether this is a kind of murder or not, it is necessary to meet certain conditions. It involves the very intention of the act, and that very intention is the key factor. That is to say, killing is an act. But what is the very intention of killing? This will determine whether the case will be considered as a manslaughter or as a murder." He further said, "What has been acknowledged by now is what kind of a fact. It is a kind of killing under careful consideration. Murder has several elements that need to be considered. Firstly, whether one kills a person after careful consideration and planning? If so, then the crime of murder has already been set up just halfway to go. Then, we would also have to look at that person who was killed by you. Whether that person has been either offensive or invasive or antagonistic to you? Was that person holding a knife towards you for killing, and so you have to resist? Was he such kind of a person? So, you have to look into this second factor as well." The Chief Justice said, "This Parker was neither offending nor antagonistic at all. If he did not have these factors, then you could not say that you were being forced to kill him. In other words, you did not have an excuse. To have an excuse, you must have sufficient evidence to support your murderous act, and which is well justified. For example, that person wanted to kill you, and because of self-defense, you had carelessly killed him. Or that you must have to kill him before you could safely defend yourself. Then, these situations could then be considered as a possible acceptable excuse. Otherwise, it could not be sufficient to become a reason to justify one's killing, nor could it be taken as a possible acceptable excuse. In terms of law, unjustifiable excuses could not be admitted as a reason for a criminal defense." The Chief Justice said that it must have to be proven as justified and was recognized as an acceptable excuse, then it could be admitted by the law. He said that in this case, there was no such situation. because that Parker was actually neither offending, nor invasive, nor antagonistic. And they had deliberately planned to kill him. Therefore, those judges, there were altogether a total of 5 judges, had repeatedly asked who was being qualified to make a decision of who should live and who should die. Were these to be considered as allowed principles or not? In the past, there were some people, emperors or tyrants, who would make some laws. These laws were made in such a way that the emperors could kill people, but civilians were not allowed to kill. That was to say, there were some sophistry in the laws that allowed those people the mastery of power to dominate and command over other people's lives. But those judges said that it was actually not possible at all. So, actually, who would be qualified? There are some learners of tantricism who are very much confused in their learnings and have made some misunderstandings of the teachings. For example, there were some cases which said that the guru ordered you to jump down from the cliff to die, and you would just simply jump and die. If you did not jump and died, that means that you were disobeying the guru, in which case you had violated the precepts. If you were dead, your guru could perform the death rituals for you and save you. Hence, you should feel relieved and just jumped down and died. These are the misunderstandings. And they are totally wrong. In this real world of Mother Nature, even those judges who do not believe in Buddhism will surely understand that actually who would be qualified to make a decision as to who should live and who should die? Is there such a principle that exists? Is it possible to use the laws and even use the kind of guru and disciple precepts to be set up as a principle? If this principle is that when you are asked to die and you have to follow suit, is this really possible? I am telling you now, this is impossible. This judge had made a remark by saying that, if this would be accepted as a principle, it would be very likely that this would be used to make some kind of an unbridled tyranny. That is, without any restraints, one would be very willfully and freely to do some very rude things and make atrocious crimes. This would actually allow someone to indulge oneself to do one thing that he likes. If it is to be cited as a kind of law, then it is simply just a legal cloak. If you indulge in this as the standard of the Buddhist Dharma, or the principle of the relationship between the guru and the disciple, this is simply just a cloak to deceive others. This is not acceptable. So, we have already discussed this case in the last 2 sessions. Some people might have misunderstood the mechanism of drawing lots. They thought that once they have been drawn by the lots to be the one to die, then they would have to die, and so they would just die willingly. Or you could justifiably announce that since he is lost in the lot drawing exercise, I could kill him. So, I have just told you that the lot drawing exercise itself, if it is to determine a person's life or death, this is just a layer of cloak, a kind of deceptive criterion. This gave you an excuse to become misunderstood, thinking mistakenly that once you have won the lot drawing exercise, it would give you the right to kill people. In fact, it is impossible. What about the moment of near-death experience? Before I explain them, there are some learners of Buddhism, including some of you who are now learning the Dharma right here, who are very much confused about some of the criteria and principles. Some people will raise their hands to say that they can kill people when they win the lot drawing. Some people will say that he is dying and will die anyway, it is better to sacrifice him and kill him, so as the others can survive. They also misunderstood that this kind of thing is considered as right and correct. So, I would like to explain it to you now. Even the judges who do not understand Buddhist Dharma know that this is not right. Therefore, as Buddhist Dharma learners, we need to be much clearer as to those justifications behind their actions. Some of your classmates have mentioned that he is dying and will die eventually, and so it is better to let him die. After all, he is an orphan, and so no one will be saddened by his death. On the other hand, if the others who have families would die, then there would be more people, particularly those of their family members, who would feel very sad about their deaths. So, if this only orphan dies, it would make most of the other people, not just the three persons who were involved, and not including their immediate families, to feel happy about this. If this is the case, then why not let this orphan die? It has also been said that, as according to the criteria mentioned earlier, if more people can be saved, then there should not be a problem in having only a very few people to die. In fact, these criteria are not feasible. Remember, all these criteria are not feasible at all. Some people think that if he voluntarily wants to be killed, he raises his hand and asks for some other people to kill him. Is this okay? We have already explained this in our last lecture. This is not okay at all. Suicide, so if I commit suicide and let the others eat me. Is this okay? Suicide is also not okay at all. In the Buddhist Dharma, all these are not considered as permissible principles. However, if that person committed suicide, then the judge will not find the three persons to be guilty under the law. However, within the perspective of the Buddhist Dharma, all these four kinds of things will not be permitted. All of these cannot be considered as permissible principles. As a result, on the December 9, 1884, all the five judges had unanimously ruled that, whether it is on the basis of legal precedent, or on the basis of ethics and morality, and under the common law, there is no existence for the justification of necessity. The justification of the defense lawyers at the time was that the three persons had the necessity to kill. It was because they were too hungry, and so if they did not kill, and if they did not eat anything, then all of them would die. After all, like it or not, it would end up with death. So, it would be better to have only one died than to have all the people died. They had used this justification of necessity, as well as that particular case of the United States, to against fight this lawsuit. Therefore, those five judges had refuted them and mentioned that all those very reasons would not stand at all, including this precedent. They said that it was not possible to use the justification of necessity as a defense for the murder. It was unacceptable at all. Therefore, the responsibility of all our judges was to formally declare that in this case, the behaviors of these prisoners were considered as a willful murder. Because they had killed a person after having careful considerations. In accordance with this special verdict, we all agreed unanimously that these prisoners were guilty of committing murder. In our last lecture, we have explained what was a special verdict. That was, the jury gave up the authority to the judges and indicated that they were ignorant, were unable to judge, and returned the jurisdiction of the case to the judges. So, the judges said that, according to the special verdict, we now had the right to make the judgment. That was, the original persons in power were the jury, and the jury handed over the power to the judges, so the judges said that they now had the jurisdiction, and they would make judgment. They were unanimously, where unanimous meant that all the five judges agreed with this argument, without any objection, sentenced the accused conviction of murder. Dudley and Stevens were sentenced to statutory death penalty, but one thing was added, and that was the prerogative of mercy. A prerogative of mercy was not a judgment, but just a suggestion to you, because I had mercy on you. That was, I would like to give you a guidance and show you a way to go. But this was not a judgment. You could choose whether to follow or not. So, this was called prerogative of mercy. Although the verdict had been made, it was not announced to the public. The judgment was made on December 9th, but till the 11th, it had not been announced to the public. Because the judges were afraid that the announcement would provoke a very intense reaction from the public opinion and the masses. If the public knew about such a judgment, they might arouse riots. Then, these judges said that to make the judgment was our responsibility. However, as for how to announce the result to the public, whether to announce it, how to suppress and calm down the riots, all these had nothing to do with us, and we would not care about these. All in all, we had already made the judgment. Therefore, no one dared to speak, nor to announce it. The entire authority did not have a channel to inform the masses of the judgment, no one dared to talk about it. Let us have a look at what this prerogative of mercy was. Actually, the prerogative of mercy was exercised by Queen Victoria, who was the reigning queen at the time. She followed a law, under which the queen needed to follow the advice of the Home Secretary. That is, if he said 1 plus 1 equal 2, then the queen could not deviate from this logic. According to his suggestion, a kind of special judgment could be made, that was, amnesty. The queen could not disagree with the Home Secretary, and she could not make a light sentence herself, because she felt sympathy for the people. She could not do this. According to the law, it requires the coexistence of the two to make amnesty. It turned out that the real power was under the Home Secretary. When the Home Secretary had written an advice, the queen could not deviate from this advice to make a judgment. Otherwise, the queen would break the law. This was stipulated in the law. Although the prisoners had been convicted, but for the death penalty, not to say the execution, the authorities dared not to make even an announcement. This power, after the shifting, finally went to the hands of the Home Secretary, named Sir William Harcourt. He personally was in favor of abolishing the death penalty. He did not think that a person committed a crime must be put to death. He felt that these criminals could be saved. You could put them in prison and educate them slowly. But he was cautious and responsible in his official duties. He was very serious and read through all the arguments and the court's judgment. He also believed that the two men were guilty of murder, not manslaughter. He personally was against the death penalty, but he also worried that commuting the sentence to life imprisonment rather than death penalty would not work. He was very concerned that if death penalty was not imposed, someone would mock the law. Even if a life sentence or a lighter sentence was given, someone would scorn at the law. They would say that the law was useless. Those who broke the law, if they gather and incite some masses, they could overturn any authority. He felt that this would make the people disrespect the law. Therefore, the effect of the law would be lost. So, he considered changing the death penalty to life imprisonment. But he did not dare to lower the penalty because he felt that there would be problems. However, after thinking about it, he found that even if it was a life imprisonment, there would be a chance to arouse riots or large-scale demonstrations. So, he wondered whether he should consult other people before making his suggestion. So, he consulted the Attorney General and the Deputy Attorney General who handled the case at the time. Sir Henry James, the Attorney General, said, "You have to think clearly before sentencing life imprisonment. You will not be able to resist the attacks of public opinion. You must make a sentence lesser than life imprisonment." The Home Secretary said, "If making a sentence lesser than life imprisonment, our law would be made fun of. It will become inane and useless." So, the Attorney General said, "I will tell you one thing. After that, you will think differently. In fact, during our trial, we found some evidence related to manslaughter. If you know how to deal with it, you may have the opportunity to commute the murder into manslaughter. If those defense lawyers were smart, they might succeed." After we found out, all the judges agreed to withhold it and not to say it. all our judges deliberately conceal this finding. And we are not ridiculing the law. We who understand the law also make concealments, and for such behavior, are we right? In fact, we are all wrong. If the jury had found it at the time and noticed the existence of the evidence of manslaughter, the judicial power would have been returned to the jury. According to the law, if it was a manslaughter, no judge would give a sentence of more than 3 months of imprisonment. It cannot be more than 3 months. Because now we had concealed this matter, we would be able to sentence them for more than 3 months imprisonment. We had made some arrangements. The Deputy Attorney General, Sir Farrar Herschel, also agreed and said, if the evidence was found, we could not sentence them more than 3 months of imprisonment. The current judgment is just because we have concealed the evidence. Think about it yourself. If they are indeed sentenced to life imprisonment, it will also lead to demonstrations. There are a lot of uncertainties, and no one can ascertain. It is very dangerous. At this moment, the crowd sentiment is surging. The government dares not to announce the judgment now. The power went to your hand. If you change the sentence to life imprisonment, though it is lesser than the death penalty, it is not feasible. We can now sentence them more than 3 months in prison. You better think about it again. So, on December 12, 1884, the Home Secretary submitted a proposal to Queen Victoria and obtained the permission of Queen Victoria. In the final judgment, the amnesty came out. In other words, although they were convicted of murder, but granted a pardon by the Queen, only were sentenced to serve 6 months in prison. It was 6 months imprisonment, which was more than 3 months. Finally, the death penalty was commuted to a lesser sentence of imprisonment for 6 months. So many people were very happy and went to inform Dudley and Stevens, saying, "You are so lucky. You have been convicted of murder, but amnesty was granted. Now you are only sentenced to 6 months in prison." Would you guess what were the reactions of these two people? They were very dissatisfied and said angrily, "We have been imprisoned for half a year, and now we have to stay in jail for another 6 months. We are not guilty at all and should not be detained even for one day. It is already wrong to detain us. Are we now sentenced to a further 6 months imprisonment?" As a result, their reactions were known to the media and boarded the newspaper. The newspaper said not only were the two being unhappy, but felt that the verdict was not correct. It was to proclaim to the world that they were guilty. What the hell was that? Both had this mentality. To achieve justice, or to achieve a balance between society and justice, the judges used stratagems and involved the Queen of England. They had succeeded in correcting the law and elevating the moral standard of future society. They had reversed successfully. So, the future moral standards of the society would be elevated. By knowing that it was guilty of murder to maintain own lives by killing others and drinking human blood. They also avoided the social turmoil. Their merits and virtues were enormous. Now let me explain to you in detail why it is not wrong for the judges to use stratagems, whereas their merits and virtues are great. But this Dudley never accepted his conviction was a fair and just judgment. He never admitted himself guilty. He felt that he was not wrong at all. Because he believed custom of the sea was correct. Everyone used to do this in the past, they were all right. Why was me having bad luck this time? After I did it, you said that I was wrong and publicized it to the world that I was wrong and I was sentenced to imprisonment. Then, I really became a sinner and my reputation was damaged. That was, I became a murderer, but I was not a murderer. And I needed to rely on amnesty to survive. What a bastard. why he had such a mentality. Because he had no moral standards, he could not know where he was wrong at all. Although people around the world or the legal interpretation let him know that he was wrong, he did not admit that. Why? It was because he had no moral standards. For sentient beings having no moral standards, how dangerous will that be? Let me tell you now. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said that it will constitute the main cause of getting a downfall for rebirth in the reincarnation. Our reincarnation can be divided into the three virtuous paths and the three evil paths. We also can reincarnate a little better, possibly to be immortals or human beings. However, if a downfall will be very miserable, we may get a downfall to the realm of hell, animals, or hungry ghosts. If there is no moral standard, it will constitute your downfall to the three evil paths. If a person is very shameless, feels fine for whatever has been done, is not ashamed, and does not like thinking, one would just like Dudley, who said that according to the previous custom of the sea, killing others is not a crime, then why I should be guilty? I will not bother to think about it. All in all, if others do this and I just follow, this is right. If one has this kind of non-thinking, shameless, no guilty at all, one will usually enter the animal's path. So, you pay attention to the animals, they are shameless and do not think. Some people have also asked me some questions about the reincarnation. Some people said that if one violates serious precepts, one will fall to hell. Then, how do the animals come? Why they are born so stupid? In fact, they do not understand one thing. There is no such a judge at all who will determine you to be reborn in animal path or any other path. In fact, it is the attractive force of your mind nature that guides you to the magnetic field of the same kind of attractive force and reincarnate in that path. That is, your mind nature is accustomed to being shameless, no guilty, no remorse, and not fond of thinking. Do you know that when your mind starts to think, the thinking wavelengths are different? If you do not like to think, your thought is almost closed and inactive, and your mind will be attracted by the same kind of magnetic field, so you will end up to the animal path. Therefore, if you enter the animal path, it is because you don't like thinking. So, it is very difficult for animals to get out of the animal path because they don't have enough energy to do it. Because their mind is accustomed to inactivity, it will not function. Just like the metabolism, when it is used to be low, it will become lower and lower and will not get higher. What can we do? Therefore, in the freeing of lives, we impart the life-releasing ritual to you. In the life-releasing ritual, it teaches you that you need to visualize emanating light to the sentient beings which will be released, and request Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara to emanate light to them as well. Because light is a kind of energy. Apart from the light from your visualization, you also request Buddhas and Bodhisattvas to add some energy to them so that their thinking can reoperate. Only if their thinking reoperates, they can get rid of the animal path. If not, in the future, even if they leave the body of animal and their Dharma nature recovered, it will disappear quickly. Far less than a second, the Dharma nature shrinks and vanishes, and they get a downfall again. The main reason is that they are not accustomed to thinking, and their thinking wave does not active, they will soon downfall to the animal path again. Therefore, once one gets into the animal path, it is difficult to get out. If you are shameless, no guilty, nor remorse, but fond of thinking, but all your thinking is to calculate others, it is a kind of bad calculation. If the bad calculation is to calculate and to covet others, you usually end up at the hungry ghost path. So, in the hungry ghost path, the greedier you desire for food, the hungrier you feel, but you cannot eat because the throat is very narrow. The more you want to be beautiful, the uglier you get. And you are bleeding all over your face. This kind of hindrance is formed because of the heavy greed. If you like thinking and your stratagems favor heavy hatred, your mind is about that person who has stepped on me and offended me. You must look for an opportunity to retaliate. These is called heavy hatred. You will usually go to the hell path. Therefore, some people have asked, if I am a person having heavy hatred and I will get angry easily, will I downfall to the hell path? Well, this depends on, first, whether you have moral standards. Second, whether you are a person who is shameless and not feeling guilty nor remorse over anything. Third, if you like thinking, are your stratagems favor greed or hatred? If you find that you have moral standards, you will feel shameful, guilty, and remorse on misconducts. Your thoughts are not to think about greed and hatred, but just easy to get angry sometimes. Then, in fact, you are not that easy to enter the three evil paths. Let's see, what is the difference for those who has moral standards? You have moral standards, you like thinking, that is, your weight band is active. When your virtuous thoughts are heavy and you are very kind, you will enter the heavenly path. If your hatred is heavy and you have virtuous thoughts, but added with some hatred, you are kind, but you get angry easily, you usually will enter the Asura path. These belong to the three virtuous paths. So, you don't have to overly worry about this, it depends on which type you belong to. Some people are worried that they are very easy to get angry. According to the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, one is easy to downfall to hell when one's hatred is heavy. Would that happen? Now, let me teach you how to identify. It depends on whether you fit in that category. In fact, there is a chance you do not belong in that category, so don't worry too much. If one is in the middle, sometimes you like to think, sometimes you don't like to think. You have virtuous thoughts, sometimes you have hatred. Then if you have everything in the middle, not to the extremes, you will usually enter human path. Just like us, we are in the middle. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had been preaching Dharma for 49 years, and in the 49 years, what did he teach us actually? In fact, he was to let all sentient beings know that everything was subject to the law of cause and effect. The Buddha said that you must establish a set of correct standards of conduct to help yourself. These correct standards of conduct are used to amend your behavior. Just as said by the person who was deeply hypnotized, he did not know why he was pushed to reincarnation, and he did not want to come back. But the elders of high-level spirituality told him that he should come back to correct the wrong things he had done. It turned out that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni was saying the same. He said, I establish a set of correct standards, and have been preached Dharma for 49 years, which is to help you, to correct your behavior. This is called Dharma practice. Many people do not understand what Dharma practice is. They mistakenly think that Dharma practice is ritual practice, to set up altar and to run ritual ceremonies. This is not. Dharma practice is to correct your behavior, and this way, you can get out of the cycle of karmic reincarnations. Otherwise, it is no use, no matter how you practice on your altar rituals. If we are going to correct our behavior, the first thing we should know, what is right and what is wrong, we need to know how to distinguish the two. Don't think that you know how to distinguish them. When questions were asked in latest lessons, many of you gave wrong answers when you raised your hands. Many of you did not know how to differentiate. So, you must know that right or wrong is not so easy to differentiate. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni also found that his disciples often violated precepts and did wrong things. Why they could do not understand? He thought it must be that he himself had not explained clearly enough. So, it was better to establish some precepts, and specified clearly what should be done and what should not be done. Would that be easier for the disciples to understand? Then, the precepts were established. Therefore, the precepts are considerably important. However, it is ignored by all the Dharma propagators nowadays. If you want to get out of the cycle of karmic reincarnations, the second thing to do is to receive training. What training is to be received? Some techniques for mind training and Dharma practice are needed. You have to make yourselves clear, in fact, the most important is the first, to differentiate right from wrong. Then go to the second, the techniques. If you don't know how to distinguish between right and wrong, the techniques you have learned will only speed up your downfall to the three evil paths. Therefore, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni and some great masters also mentioned bodhisattva's fear causes. Bodhisattva are persons who truly understand Dharma practice. Persons with wisdom. Before they make each cause, they are already worried that they might commit mistakes. So, before taking any action, they think it thoroughly first, whether it is right or wrong, whether it will break the precepts. Like those judges, they knew exactly what they were doing. Knowing that some evidence of manslaughter were displayed which might be used by the defendant to counterattack, the judges concealed it immediately. The judges knew what they were doing. Then, they told the Home Secretary that they, all five judges, knew the evidence, and they deliberately concealed it. All of them were aware of what they were doing. They were not confused. And it was not that they were not clear about what they were doing. So, bodhisattvas are within this category, they know. Before any actions, they will worry about making mistakes and will make the choice to do it or not to do it. But sentient beings do not care, do not want to trouble, do not want to think, do whatever they like to do, and do what they want. Therefore, their behavioral patterns cannot be changed, even though they try to change for many times. But when the retributions come, they will be scared. We need to remember this. There are a lot of Dharma propagators who only pay attention to the skills of Dharma practice. He teaches you how to visualize, give offerings, worship, set up altars, and to perform all sorts of skills, such as how to make offerings to the Dharma protectors, and how to recite the prayers so that the Dharma protectors will be happy. The skills also include what items are to be offered to please the Dharma protectors. Different ritual instruments can get certain effects, and the vibration frequency may also be different. He may teach you all kinds of skills, but there are no precepts or how to distinguish between right and wrong. The precepts are not even valued. In addition, the person who teaches you is also violating precepts. That is to say, learn to run before learning to walk, and this kind of Dharma practice will not be successful. Why? It will be useless even if you are familiarized with these skills. Because it is your mind nature which will follow the attractive force, determines your reincarnation. And not these skills. No matter how good you are at visualization, you are not able to resist the attraction of karma. That attractive force is too great. Therefore, the mind nature is the last thing that determines the path you will reincarnate. So, you must remember the essential first step is to distinguish between right and wrong, how to respect and observe the precepts. After all these, you go to learn the skills. In this way, you will be fine. Otherwise, there must be problems. How people judge the standards of right and wrong. Most of us take herd mentality as the standard of right and wrong. In a word, most people say that it is right, then it is right. They use this kind of behavior as the right or wrong standards. So did some of you here, last time, when you raised your hands to answer questions, I could see that many of you were using the herd mentality. So, you need to be careful. For example, they feel that smoking is stylish. Speaking foul language is to get resonance, otherwise there will be no conversation. These are some weird phenomena in this society. They do not have their own independent thinking. They are very difficult to quit after they are addicted, especially smoking. Nicotine from cigarettes, when inhaled, will stick together with certain substances inside your body and make you addicted. So, only a few people, less than 10%, can rely on determination to successfully quit smoking. Usually, more than 90% of the people cannot just rely on determination to quit smoking. They need some additional methods to assist. That is, similar to our Dharma practice, sometimes, in addition to the observance of precepts, knowing how to distinguish between right and wrong, we need to know some methods and techniques. You have to remember. Why do I bring up smoking? Because we, as Buddhist practitioners, must quit smoking. Our master, His Holiness Chadral Rinpoche, had quoted from the scriptures and explained that when we smoke, there would form an energy field and seal our central channel. Needless to say, your interior is already fouled, and your outside will also have an energy field sealing your central channel. In the future, when you die, you definitely cannot go away from upwards and reincarnation to good places. You can only choose to exit from downwards, and you will not have options to go upward. No matter how many virtuous deeds you do, you can only go downwards. If your mind nature is comparatively good, you will only be a bit better in the downward direction. That is, you will be reborn at the upper middle level at most, you have no way to go further up. So, you have to remember that if you are a Dharma practitioner who is smoking, no matter what method is used, you must try all means to quit it. You must quit smoking. There was one time, we requested His Holiness Chadral Rinpoche to take a taxi to the hotel for giving us the Dharma teaching of four foundations of preliminary practices. At that time, we requested Chadral Rinpoche to personally teach the four foundations of preliminary practices, and we brought some students to receive the teaching. It was very difficult to be able to request Chadral Rinpoche to give Dharma transmission personally. He would not give Dharma transmission even people were requesting and knocking at his door. As for requesting him to travel to your place and give Dharma transmission, it was very difficult. But we were able to invite Rinpoche to go to the hotel. He was late for more than 10 minutes. We asked about the reason. It turned out that there was a problem with the taxi that was arranged by us. Originally, it was arranged to pick up Rinpoche at the monastery and go to the hotel. Unexpectedly, when Chadral Rinpoche opened the door and smelled a strong smell of smoke, he immediately refused to get on the taxi. He said that if we could not find a car without smoke, he would rather not to give Dharma transmission. Why? It turns out that this energy field will seal the central channel. Dharma practicing will not be easy for any Dharma practitioner. Just like Chadral Rinpoche, he had retreats and practiced Dharma in the cave for decades. He came out to propagate Dharma only after the age of 50, as he confirmed having attained achievement and believed that there was no problem. Before he was 50, he had Dharma practice in the cave. He practiced so hard in order to maintain the purity of his energy field, but now, the given cigarette-smoked car would trap him. It is just like to suffocate cockroaches in a closed room with insect spray. It was not easy at all for him to have maintained this energy field through Dharma practice. He, of course, would not get into that vehicle. He said that he would not take this car. In the end, there was a disciple around Chadral Rinpoche. He had a car and certainly did not smoke. He immediately went home, took his car and drove Chato Rinpoche to our hotel, so he was late. From this, it shows that a genuine Dharma practitioner is so cautious. You may misunderstand and say, is there a need to be so cautious? If, a few days ago, you have read reports on the internet or news, a person during an interview said that if you inhale a little nicotine, the nicotine can enter into your system and bond with certain substances. Once sticking together, they cannot be separated. So, you rely on determination to quit smoking, the chance of success is very low. Because after the bonding, the nicotine will control over you and you will be addicted. If you want to quit, you must add the above methods. The person who was interviewed at the time gave this answer. So, I also quote and tell you as it is the same for Dharma practice. It is just like Chato Rinpoche, even for a little bit of nicotine, he did not want to inhale. Why? Because this would destroy certain substances in his body and it would stick to something, he did not want to be affected. It was because his body and the entire magnetic field were very pure, there was no reason to inhale these stuffs to destroy it. Therefore, you must not think that Chato Rinpoche was overly persevering and pedantic. It was not. Because this is the thing that we must insist, so that we can be liberated from the cycle of karmic reincarnations. Some people, whose practice has not yet attained that level, but they have already said that they have to let go, do not have attachments. Whether or not they can be liberated from reincarnation is not a problem, just do it casually and be relaxed. These are the wrong ideas. So, remember, if we say that we don't want to get out of reincarnation, it doesn't matter, we have to let go, whether we are liberated from reincarnation is not a problem. Such words will fall into our mind consciousness. This way, we really cannot get out of reincarnation. So, one cannot let these ideas fall into one's mind consciousness. Therefore, for a Dharma propagator, although he himself has not violated any precepts, he is good, he also has observed precepts, but still he needs to be careful about his teachings. Why? Because there are certain mistakes that he cannot make in his teaching. For example, to teach some people to let go of everything, to have no attachments, to deny reincarnation, to have no problem whether or not they can get out of reincarnation. All these teachings, if taught to the disciples who are not of this standard, that is, they have not yet reached this level, they have not yet mastered the reincarnation. But you have taught them these teachings. And these teachings have entered their mind consciousness, then they really cannot escape from the cycle of karmic reincarnations. This is very serious and will create obstacles and affect their future reincarnations in many light years. Therefore, as a Dharma propagator, he must be careful and must not wag his tongue too freely. In this case, the people in power were very fond of thinking. Have you noticed? The stratagem made by these lawyers was marvelous. These is called wisdom. They were very fond of thinking. Without thinking, basically wisdom cannot be developed. They had ethical standards and many virtuous thoughts. If they were not, they would not rack their brains and hope to elevate the spiritual civilization of mankind. They had stratagems. When there was a herd mentality and a correct moral standard fighting with each other, they needed to exercise stratagems. Are these stratagems right or wrong? In fact, there were signs of manslaughter that could be used for defense, but they also deliberately concealed and turned a blind eye. As judges, are they right or wrong? These, we have all explained in the previous lecture, and now, I will mention it briefly. The overall civilization evolution of mankind is very important. If something is done and will have a bad or descending impact on the mind nature, then it is wrong, such as violent games. It is because the elevation of the overall mind nature of mankind overrides social liberalism. There are many people who say that I have freedom. I like to watch violent movies. Why do you want to interfere with me? For example, you are a guru and you tell your disciples that there is a precept prohibiting violent movies, because these movies will increase your hatred and therefore they are not allowed. Some people will argue with liberalism and ask, why are they not allowed? Become a guru, are you the supreme? Do I have to follow your set? I like it, and I have my option. But I am telling you now, being a guru, it really cannot be approved. Because if that incident is wrong, he needs to ask the disciples not to do it. The alternative is that you are not his guru. You can only have two choices, either you do not act as his guru, or as his guru, you have to disapprove. You cannot say, there is liberalism. I have already taught him and I will not be bothered if he does not listen to me. I have no responsibility to control him. We have liberalism and everyone is responsible for himself. If so, you get it wrong. In tantric, it turns out to be like this. The guru is just like a big cow. It has a big ring on his nose. The big ring carries a lot of ropes and each rope holds a calf, that is his disciple. Now, he is taking them to get out of the cycle of karmic reincarnations. The situation is similar to climbing up the mountains. This is an example recorded by our ancestral master and I just tell it accordingly. He said that while the big cow climbs up the mountain, the nose pulls that group of disciples, there are many of them, let's say 10, in fact, the guru is very toilsome. Its own body is so big, climbing up on its own is already very toilsome, but needs to carry so many calves, it is very toilsome. Why is he toilsome? Why are there connecting ropes? Because for anything he does, any sentence he says, there will be an impact on these disciples. If these disciples have an accident, he will also bear the consequence. Then, do you have any justifications? Is it only form the tantric? Has Mahayana Buddhism said about it? Yes, it has. I will show you later a section of the sutra, and you will know that the justification has been mentioned. And the sutra has also talked about how to calculate. Buddha Shakyamuni also exhibited an equation to teach you how to calculate. I will teach you the calculation later. If there is a guru, for something that is obviously wrong, such as watching violent movies, he said to the disciples, I say that you cannot watch them, but if you watch them, it is your business. I have said that it is not allowed. It is also wrong to speak like this. It turns out that the guru must speak adamantly that all of you are not allowed to watch violent movies, which will increase your hatred. In case your compassion is not enough, you will have the opportunity to enter the hell path. So, I don't approve of watching violent movies. Whoever watches violent movies, I will no longer teach him and will no longer be his guru. That is, we call it Brahmadanda, or one is asked to resign from the association because it is a blatant disregard for the guru. If you don't listen to me, I will stop being your guru. Why is he so determined? This is because, if he continues to be your guru, he has told you, but there is no follow-up, and you continue to watch your violent movies. Then when you, as the disciple, downfall to hell, the guru will be dragged and cannot enter the Dharma realm. There will be pulling related to causes and effects, because that rope is connected. Therefore, Tantric Sutra said that if there are too many disciples downfall at the same time, the guru, that is the cow, will downfall together. The disciples go to hell, and the guru is also going to hell. In hell, he teaches those disciples again. The guru knows that he cannot lead these disciples in this way, so he has to train his own thinking and leads these disciples starting from scratch. Starting from scratch, they climb upwards from hell. Originally, they are climbing upwards in the human realm, but now they have got a downfall to hell and are climbing upwards in hell. This is it, the guru will also downfall to hell to retrain those disciples, and he cannot let go, because there are ropes connected. Therefore, there is a precept for the guru, that is to tell the disciples adamantly whether it is feasible or not. The guru cannot choose the middle. Either you are not his guru, or else, the guru has to bear this cause and effect. This is the case. Some people do not understand, and sometimes, when the guru is very strict, they will criticize the guru. They said that one must certainly not choose a strict guru. The best choice is one with casual attitude, and that is acceptable. To be casual, that means there is no moral standard. That is to say, if he wants to be a guru, he can be so bad who robs someone else's guru position and deceive others by saying that he has received the lineage. As long as he can be a guru, he can do anything. He himself has no moral standards, coupled with teaching you the greed, the hatred, or not telling you adamantly the things you cannot do, then both of you will downfall to hell. However, in the future, after the fall to hell, he does not have a standard to lead you getting out, because he does not have this standard himself. Whereas, a guru with this standard, if he does not speak adamantly, he will downfall to hell also. After revising his standards, then he can lead himself and his disciples to liberate. So, you have to think carefully. If even a guru may be like this, then don't you need to be very careful when choosing your guru? If you do not choose a strict guru, although you may be worried that the guru will drive you away, but it is still better than following him to fell to hell without a chance for both of you to get out of hell. You have no reason to choose the guru this way. Therefore, to choose a guru, you should choose one who is comparatively stringent. Even you do not choose a strict guru, but do not choose one that has no moral standards, because this is very serious. The overall civilization progress of mankind is actually very important, that is to say, if it is helpful for the elevation of mind nature, it is right. Just like this case, because it has an overall elevation in the human mind nature, it overrides the principle of fairness. When these five judges found some signs of manslaughter, they immediately concealed them and prevented the jury from detection, so that they could not seize the jurisdiction to judge the case. This kind of thing is unfair, but if their goal is to elevate the overall human civilization and mind nature, then they are right. Why? Because this incident overrides the principle of fairness, so it is no longer necessary to argue about fairness. It needs to be concealed, so conceal it. Do you understand? So, they are not wrong. But does the Buddhist Holy Dharma look at it this way? You have to know that the law can be changed. The law was originally formulated by people. Why can't it be changed? And the principle in the Buddhist Holy Dharma has stated that there is only one principle which must not be changed. What is that principle? If it makes the mind nature elevate, then it is right. If that incident makes the mind nature descend, it is wrong. This principle cannot be changed. We have said it in our last lecture. Let us verify it again now. Was his kind of stratagem right or wrong? Let us verify it again. In this case, the person in power was guiding the jury to the wrong direction and deceiving them, telling them that they were ignorant and did not know how to make the judgment. The jury are better to admit that they were ignorant and handed over the power. This was guiding them to the wrong direction. Concealing the facts, that was, during their trial, they found signs of manslaughter and chose to conceal them. Then, they made the correct judgment that was confirmed a conviction of murder and sentenced the defendants to death. The conviction of murder had made the moral standards elevated so they could save and elevate the mind nature of future generations. But, to save the existing generation, that was not workable. Because, people of the existing generation were in surging sentiments and everyone felt that killing was not a problem. However, the moral level of the future development had been elevated. The mind nature elevation of the future generations could be saved. So, this was for the future. But why did they make a recommendation for mercy? Why was it called mercy? The reason for being called mercy was because these lawyers and judges would feel that these people were actually ignorant. They did not know that this was a wrongdoing, and they had no moral standards, which had now made themselves to be like this. In fact, they were also very pitiful. They did it this because they did not know that they were wrong. In addition, the people many years ago also did lots of cases the same way. As a result, they did not know where their own mistakes were. It was actually very pitiful. As this was the case, it was better to allow them a way out. So, they made a judgment of amnesty. The judgment would maintain the mind nature of the people in the society, so it would not continue to decline. Because if he did not quote the recommendation of mercy and asked them to go to the Queen of England for the amnesty, those people would definitely come out to riot. Of course, there would be casualties in the riots and a loss of property in the stores. The situation would be like this certainly. Then everyone's mind nature would be blinded, and people would say, "You can make your judgment, but I will continue to kill. If there are shipwrecks in the future, I will kill a few more people. I want you to know that this custom of the sea is correct." Then their mind nature would become more blind and then descend. In the riots, the herd mentality would appear, people would shout slogans together, and yell, "We are right to kill people like this." Then, each person would repeat the phrase, "We are right to kill people like this." So, the mind nature would become more realistic. Originally, some people were neutral without knowing right or wrong. When so many people were saying right, so it was right. After shouting the slogans for several times, their whole mind nature would become realistic, that was, to kill people this way would be right. As a result, their mind nature would descend. So, there is the opportunity for riots to make people's mind nature to elevate, and there is the opportunity of a descent also, because it is a radical approach. When a radical approach, urged by a herd mentality and a crowd-surging sentiment, mind nature will either elevate or descend depending on what kind of slogan that people are calling. Therefore, those riots with slogans shouting is an act that has the opportunity to make others' mind nature to descend. Of course, there is also a chance of elevation, depending on what kind of riots. But when it is called riots, mostly it would result mind nature to descend. Demonstrations could be regarded in the middle. It is possible for one to see a bit clearer whether it is elevating or descending. But for riots, it must be descending. So, one must not create riots, might have demonstrations, but not riots. Well, all of us have actually missed something. Oh. That is to say, observing things, you have to see a bit clearer. If you are a principleist, how do you see this incident? You will say that to guide a wrong direction is wrong, and all in all, is wrong. If you are a principleist, you will say that hiding the facts, that is lying, is not right. Many people confuse the Buddhist Holy Dharma principles with principlism. So, now I want to teach you how to distinguish them. You have mixed them up. We talk about the precept forbidding lying in the five precepts. To conceal the facts, that is lying, of course is not feasible and is wrong. you will say this. You will also say that this is the Buddhist holy dharma. Then you will also say, guiding a wrong direction is deceiving others, and is wrong, certainly, and this is a violation of the five precepts. Then you will also say, the descent of mind nature of the current society, will it be related to us? All in all, the most important is that the recommendation for mercy has distorted the verdict. The fact is that the death sentence is judged, then death penalty has to be imposed, because killing has to be paid with one's life. Killing does not require pay with one's life, then it is lying. Factually, you have sentenced him to death and being guilty of committing murder. Two things were sentenced, but in the end, because you were afraid of those people, you made an amnesty and changed to a 6 months imprisonment. These are called fake mask. These are deceiving people, so will be said to be wrong. Because it does not conform to the principle, and there is no reason to make the change after a sentence of being guilty in committing a murder has been made, so it is wrong. Principleist will only take one thing as correct, that is the correct judgment. Many people have misunderstood and thought that the Buddhist holy dharma is the same. You need to figure it out. The Buddhist holy dharma does not use this principleism, but use the one that I just taught, that is the only one criterion. Okay. Let's see how utilitarianism is like. Utilitarianism will say that the guiding of wrong direction is correct. As long as it is beneficial to the overall situation, not going to riot, that is right. Concealing the facts, of course, is correct as long as the concealed facts are good for that incident. All in all, it is feasible if the incident benefits, it is not a problem to conceal the facts. They will also say that you are, of course, on the right course to make an amnesty. Amnesty can make riots not to be aroused, so is right. He will also say that the correct judgment is wrong. You make a death sentence. Do you want to arouse riots? Do you want more people to die? Of course, it is not good. How will there be so many shipwrecks? There will not be one shipwreck among 100 ships. You, for not hoping that the future people to eat people again in a shipwreck, want to make this kind of sentence, which will arouse riots and more people will die immediately. Doing this, of course, is not right. So, he will say that you are wrong. Utilitarianism is like this. What about the Buddhist holy dharma? The Buddhist holy dharma said, if it makes the mind nature elevate, it is right, and if it makes the mind nature descend, it is wrong. So, if now, it is to guide the wrong direction, then it has to look at your motive. If your motive is to elevate the progress of human spiritual civilization, then in this incident, the Buddhist holy dharma will consider that you are doing this for the elevation of mind nature. So it will say that you are right. To conceal the facts, if you can really help the elevation of mind nature, it will also say that you are right. If you use amnesty, and turmoil can be avoided, no turbulence, the public's mind nature is not getting a downfall. First, let's not say elevating, at the very least, the mind nature remains stable, not falling, everyone's mind nature will downfall in a riot. So the Buddhist holy dharma will consider that you are right. You are also right to use the correct method to judge this incident. Because the wisdom that is said in the Buddhist holy dharma is actually to make all these things done. In fact, wisdom is for doing all these things, so the Buddhist holy dharma will definitely say that all these are right. And originally, it is necessary to use a method and come up with that solution to solve this case. Therefore, in the Bodhicitta precepts, it is stated what is not a violation of the Bodhicitta precepts. There is a criterion, and this criterion is to be remembered and is to be recited. We, as Dharma practitioners, are required to recite this. It states, if you do something with full pity, mercy, and benevolence, it is not a violation. So, for the precepts reciting in our Upavasatha of our association, this sentence is recited by everyone. After reading it several times, they can recite it. That is to say, if you do something with full pity, mercy, and kindness, and these three things added together equal to the elevation of the mind nature, then this is called no violation. If you say, for compassion, I kill him and after killing him, take his flesh and give it to other people to eat, so that they are not starved to death, this is wrong. We have said this in our last lesson, as I have explained it, I will not explain again here. It is because this will make the descent of mind nature for more people. So, you have to figure this out. But if these three things, pity, mercy, and kindness, are added together, will make an elevation of mind nature, he is not wrong. So, for this whole incident, if you use the Buddhist Holy Dharma criterion, it can be seen in this way. Let's see a bit clearer. If you are doing things with principlism, you will only do one thing, that is, to make a correct verdict, and you will not do other things, and so, social turmoil will be formed. That is, if you were that judge, you would create social unrest. That is, if you are holding this in your Dharma practice, the downside is that obstacles will often appear in your doings. You will easily have a lot of constraints, your promotion speed will be slow, you will be very stiff, you will easily have one-sided paranoid, you do not understand what is balance. You are rushing constantly just like a cow. But there is an advantage, and you are not easily shaken. You are not an easily shaken person, you have principles to do things. If you are a utilitarian, you will only make a favorable verdict. You will not do it if there is no benefit. You will form a kind of blind herd mentality. That is to say, if you are a person with power and you are a public figure, your way of doing things will guide all the people to have a kind of blind herd mentality. And similarly, you are a star who have many fans following you, so your every move and all your words and actions will have influence. If you are a utilitarian and a business person, where a business person can easily become a utilitarian, you are also a public figure, not only famous but have a lot of people following you, then you have to be careful, you will easily set up a blind herd mentality. For any utilitarian, the downside is that there is often confusion in his dealings. Because, when favorable things suddenly appear, he will change the decision, and as greater benefits appear, he will change the decision again, it changes continuously, and a kind of chaos is formed. He will easily have a downfall in his mind nature, including incarnation. According to some people who have previous life memories, some are put under deep hypnosis, they tell the situations when their rebirths take place. It turned out that a scene appeared, some saw a forest, and there was a beautiful woman in front of the forest. She lured him to walk over, and in this way, he entered into the womb. Some of them saw a lot of tasty food, very delicious, and he kept eating, and in this way, he fell to the animal realm and became a pig. All in all, they would see some scenes, and those scenes appeared because you are a utilitarian. If you are a Buddhist Dharma practitioner, your guru will tell you. I will teach more details. I will teach you in the camp training class in the future. In your future incarnation, when you see some scenes appeared, what are those you need to avoid? What are those you need to change or to cover with a changed scene? There are many kinds of methods. These are the things that ordinary people do not understand. People may see some scenes, and because they are utilitarian, that are having a greedy mind, the scenes they see usually appear to be very beautiful palaces. Some are ordinary palaces, and some others are very beautiful palaces. Some emit light that is very soft and comfortable, others emit very glaring light, and the people make their choices. The Tibetan Book of the Deaf has also recorded these situations. Usually, the utilitarian will choose the soft light and beautiful palaces. The utilitarian will choose like this, which thus give rise to a rebirth. Therefore, our mind nature is very important. If you act without principles, you will easily walk a fallacious road. What I said about to walk a fallacious road includes the road to your rebirth, which is also a fallacious road. What are the advantages? In some aspects, smooth and obstacle-free roads will appear, that is, the rebirth will also be smooth and obstacle-free, that is. Your downfall to the animal realm is also faster than the other people. Just like when a beautiful woman beckons to you and you follow her, you have a downfall to the animal realm immediately. Therefore, a smooth and obstacle-free road is very easy to have an accident. Easy to solve the problems. In the real society, if one understands the human feelings, one can of course solve the problems easily. In the Buddhist Holy Dharma, we said that there are two criterions. In fact, we need to pay attention to these two criterions, because they are easily to be misunderstood or to be missed out. What have we missed? That is, it is easy to confuse these two criterions of the Buddhist Holy Dharma with principlism. As such, you will feel that it is only necessary to do this. Just follow that judge's practice and make the correct verdict will be fine. This will become a principleist. However, in fact, the real Buddhist Holy Dharma is to talk about wisdom, to choose the third, to see if I have a solution to balance these two things. The balance, as said, if it makes a descent of mind nature, should we still do it? What you want is balance, that is, take a bit here and supplement there, that is, even it is a bit wrong, you also do it? No, it is not to be explained like this, you must not make it wrong. We cannot have a one-sided and non-comprehensive approach. In fact, looking at it a bit clearer, the correct verdict and the recommendation for mercy, these two things are actually a balance. Then, will the recommendation for mercy make the mind nature descend? If it will, then it is not feasible. In fact, it will not. As I have just explained that the recommendation for mercy can make the mind nature of those people not to drop drastically now, and at the very least, to be kept stable. They will not immediately go to the riots, shout slogans that makes the mind nature to firm up and makes a real descent of mind nature, and so, at least, these can be avoided. Therefore, the recommendation for mercy, though cannot make an elevation of mind nature, can keep the mind nature stable and not to descend, this thing is called balance. This thing which we all have to pay attention is called wisdom. But if this recommendation for mercy makes a descent of mind nature, it is wrong, this cannot be called balance and you cannot do it. You cannot take some credit from the correct verdict and put it in the recommendation for mercy, this is not feasible and these two cannot be balanced. Please remember. If the correct verdict can make an elevation of mind nature, while the recommendation for mercy makes a descent of mind nature, one is right and one is wrong, these two cannot make a balance. Remember. But if this recommendation for mercy is to keep the mind nature from descending, while it cannot make it rise, it cannot make it fall, then these two can be mixed to make a balance. In fact, the so-called balance, that is, mixing together, so that the two will not be one side loaded and biased, this is called balance. That is to say, if it makes an elevation of mind nature, then it is right, we must do it. If it makes a descent of mind nature, then it is wrong, we must not do it. We still have a third thing. In our Buddhist Holy Dharma criterion, on the aspect of mind nature, we must add one thing that is to help the balance of mind nature. This needs to be done also. It is to have these three things added up, then it is correct. Remember, whatever makes the mind nature not to descend, only keeps it stable, it is then called a balance of mind nature. This is already considered as balance. All of these have to be done, then there is the hope of getting out of the cycle of karmic reincarnations. Why did the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni use 49 years and make so many precepts to teach us to distinguish between right and wrong? This is because how to distinguish between right and wrong is extremely important. When we are wrong, it is useless no matter what we have practiced. Our mind nature will go to the wrong place, so we will reincarnate to some unpleasant places. Even if you know a lot of skills, such as visualization, they are not enough to resist the karma force that is pulling you. With your poor mind nature, which is heading for the wrong place, you have no reason not to get a downfall. And when your visualization is very weak, while those karma forces are very strong, your mind nature has already been led, and you want to rely on your little bit of visualization to elevate. It is impossible. Therefore, the mind nature is having a decisive function. So, you must remember that all the three things have to be done. Now, let us look at the person in power. The person in power, at that time, was exposed to public opinion. At that time, public opinion and the person in power competed with each other, and that changed the final outcome. You have to remember, the stronger power the persons have, the more careful they should be in their thoughts and behaviors. Just like walking on the steel line, only a little carelessness will endanger the interests of the majority. Any decision they make will have a profound impact on the whole society and even the entire world. Okay. I am teaching you now to make calculation using the equations taught by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni. Although, we say that the judges who came up with the stratagem are not wrong, but being not wrong does not equal to having no cause and effect retribution. I have already said that sometimes you are doing the right thing, but as long as you have not got out of the cycle of karmic reincarnations, have not yet entered the Dharma realm, have remained in this secular, you are controlled by the law of cause and effect, you still have the cause and effect. What was that cause and effect? I concealed the facts and taught the person to find the Queen of England to do amnesty, and they did not have to be sentenced to death, then what was the cause and effect on me? I did this for the sake of having a good mind nature, so I was right. It turned out that there would be cause and effect also. Then, let us have a look at what has been written in the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's equation. In the Mahayana Sutra of Mind Ground Contemplation, Section 2, Part 1, Gratitude Reward, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said that if there is a kingdom, it can be a country or an organization. And there is a person who has done virtuous deeds, that is, doing some good things which, of course, have virtuous, consequential effects. The reward achieved by one will be divided into seven portions. That is, the blessed reward from his virtuous deed will be divided into seven portions. One who does a good deed deserves five portions. He said that the person who does this good deed will only get five portions. For one's king, that is, the king of this country, here does not refer to the king, it refers to the person in power. This was the word used by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni in his preaching. In fact, it means the person in power. Often gets two portions, he will get two portions. It is a virtuous cause, for the king has also shared the virtuous deed. What does this sentence mean? Why is it so nice for him getting two portions? This is because the ruler of that country has done the same virtuous deed. What virtuous deed has he done? That is, he has created the virtuous environment and atmosphere that forms a virtuous cause. This has offered those people an opportunity to do virtuous deeds. That is to say, this ruler often does some moral education and teaches the people to do virtuous deeds. This is explained by connecting the previous contents. In the previous sections, he said that the rulers in this country, or the person in charge in a family, who are the parents, deliver moral education to some people, let them know how to do these virtuous deeds. And for the virtuous deeds done by these people, 2/7 of the merits will be given to the person in power. It is the same for making 10 evil karma, he said. If you make 10 kinds of evil behaviors, this phenomenon will also appear. This is a phenomenon of cause and effect connecting. That is to say, if you rule a country, you are a person in power, you implement some laws or create some environments to condone some people to do bad things. As a result, anyone in this country who has done evil things is not punished, just like to kill people without paying one's life, and if this is the case, the evil karmic retribution will be divided into 7 portions. 5/7 will be attributed to the person who did the evil deed and the 2/7 will be given to the person in power. That is, whoever makes the judgment for this case and allowing one to kill people without paying one's life, then the judge will receive 2/7 of the karmic retribution. It is of the same reason, that is, the same reason will apply. All things that are produced in the fields and gardens of this country, all to be divided into 7 portions. What does this sentence mean? This sentence means that, in the same way, all things that are produced in the fields and gardens of the country will be divided into 7 portions. Another example is, just like a family, all your furniture and belongings are divided into 7 portions. If you can make your country thriving and technologically advanced, that is, all citizens live in peace and work happily, or can create for your family an atmosphere where everyone can live in harmony and everything is good. Or, it is that the citizens are unable to live and the country is backward and dilapidated. That is, in your country, the people have poor livelihood and nothing to eat, and the buildings seem to collapse. These are all related to the governance of the rulers, and so the rulers will bear a 2/7 of the good or bad karmic retributions. In this scripture, it is also recorded that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said, "If there is a king who has the right knowledge and insights, which are exercised appropriately in this world to teach the people, will be named the God of heaven." He said that if there is a ruler, he has the right knowledge and insights, and he uses the knowledge and insights to teach the people of this world, he can be called as the God of heaven. Why giving him the name as the God of heaven? It is because the things that he knows and applies are actually the virtuous dharma of the heavenly realm. And he is applying the virtuous dharma of the heavenly realm to enlighten the people in the human world. How to get to the heavenly realm? What you need is exactly the morality of those judges. Therefore, the merits that was planted by these judges will enable them to reach the heavenly realm. After they die, because those in the heavenly realm all have the standards of these levels. Now the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said this, "Why can he be called the God of heaven?" It is because he uses virtuous dharma of the heavenly realm to enlighten the world. That is to say, these standards of methods will only exist in the heavenly realm. If you can apply it to the human world, there is no difference with God. So you can be called the God of heaven. Moreover, all the virtuous gods of the heavens and the king of protectors will often come to bless and protect him and his residents. Although this ruler is in the human world, his act of practicing belongs to the behavior of the heavenly realm, because he is not biased in rewarding and punishing. If you look at the text in classical Chinese, the scripture says this, "The virtuous gods of heavens and the king of protectors often come to bless and protect their palaces." Although having presence in the human world, they are practicing the heavenly norms. That is, even though he is in the human world, all his actions are the behaviors only performed in the heavenly realm. The act of reward and punishment is unbiased with no separate faction, that is to say, because he is very clear in rewarding and punishing, there is no bias, no partiality, and no separate faction. This is the way that all the kings of sages handle affairs. All should act like this. So, he said, the standard of all the kings of sages to handle affairs are like this. For this kind of holy king, he will be named king of Dharma. If the person in power can act like this, we will call him the king of Dharma. Let us take a look now. This kind of thing can be extended to a family, a group, can be a Buddhist group also, or a Dharma propagator. As a Dharma propagator, his words and behaviors affect the mind nature and the wisdom of others, so this is actually very important. It will lead the reincarnation of others to elevate or to descend, and is the most direct impact. It is more direct than your teachers and parents. This guru, that is the person who teaches you Dharma, his impact on you is so enormous. His influence is not only in this life, but also the afterlife and numerous lifetimes afterwards. Therefore, we must choose a guru very carefully. We must choose a guru with ethical standards. However, the current situation is very poor. Many propagators nowadays have no moral standards. They do things unscrupulously. The situation is even worse for some of those teaching tantric. You can have a look of those tantric practitioners and you will get to know what type of person his guru is. When you look at the behavior of that disciple, you will almost know what type of person his guru is. Nowadays, the tantric Dharma practitioners are all talking about blessing, talking about the powerfulness of Dharma instruments, but not to talk about precepts observance. Just talking about his Dharma instruments and the powerfulness of his Dharma ritual, which can overwhelm other people. All he says is how to overpower other people and to override others. And then, he also talks about how to get rich when doing business and what difficulties are solved. What they say is what utilitarianists often say. They will not talk about the precepts. They will also not talk with you the truth of Buddhist holy Dharma. All their sayings are the stuffs of utilitarianism. They do things very unscrupulously and without moral standards. So, this is dangerous. If a Dharma propagator has no moral standards, all the disciples that follow him will, in the future, have no moral standards, and they will have the same kind of mind nature. In the end, they will downfall together to the three evil paths. The guru and the disciples will also downfall. After they all go down, these disciples will expect the guru to save them in hell because they are stuck together. In particular, as they have vowed to be together for countless lifetimes and not to be separated, this situation will arise. So, the reason why a cow is connected with so many lines, it is because they have made many vows. They have already sworn. So, be very careful when choosing the guru and making an oath with him. What type of person is this guru? You have to look at his group, the behavior of the Dharma brothers and sisters. Basically, you can know roughly what type of person your guru is. If he often disobeys the precepts and scold that discipline is an obsession and ask why are you so persistent? There is no right or wrong, we can be liberated if we know how to practice the Dharma. I have a Dharma brother who said something even more crazy. He said, as long as I have a way to get the position of the guru, I will never downfall. How can a guru fall? As a guru, there will be blessing from lineage masters from the above. I am the next one to inherit the lineage, they will always look after me. There is no reason that they are above, and I am below, it cannot be like this. He passed it on to me. Isn't it the lineage? Look, when you recite the lineage, you read out the name of the first guru, the second guru, and all the lineage masters, read them out one by one, and I am the 17th. There is no reason to jump from the 16th to 18th, missing out the 17th, for I have got a downfall, it will not be like this. So, as long as I grab the position of the guru and become a guru, I guarantee myself that I will not downfall. So, I have to be someone else's guru in the future. That's what I mean. However, you have to understand one thing. It really doesn't matter at all what title you call, what guru you are. And the sequence of inheritance, all of them are your own nonsenses, assuming that the 16th ancestor has made you to be the 17th, it is true, it is even worse if it is fake. Assuming it is true, if your mind nature is not good, you will also get a downfall. So, some people do not understand one thing, if they do not respect the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, do not follow the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's teaching and practices, and feel that their practice is better than the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, these people have already entered the evil path and have said fallacies. This is not correct. It is just like making a car behind closed doors and ordained yourself as the king. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni is our root master, but some tantric practitioners dare to say that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's dharma is very ordinary, and their tantric dharma is more powerful than his. Or to say that his dharma is different from theirs. These are all wrong. All are the same. Therefore, people who talk these nonsenses are not practicing tantric. Do not claim yourselves as dharma practitioners and destroy the image of tantric Buddhism. Nowadays, there are some dharma propagators, not only those practicing tantric, but also some exoteric Buddhism practitioners. They are not doing the right thing. In fact, we do not care whether he is exoteric or esoteric Buddhism practitioner, we do not look at this. Just look at the behavior of that person, is it in line with the precepts? Is it in line with the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's saying? This is the important point. That is what he says and what he teaches his disciples to do, in line with Buddha Shakyamuni's saying? Does he quote his words? Does he obey the precepts? These are the most important. Never trust others saying how powerful their lineage is and his inheritance of the lineage. You have no way to prove whether it is true or false, so you do not have to prove it, just look at his behavior. It is also useless even if you can prove. It also depends on his behavior. So now, the first criterion of this Buddhist Dharma is that it is right to make the mind nature elevate, it is wrong to make the mind nature descend. Things that help the balance of mind nature, you have to do it. Can these criterions be introduced into everyday life? Then you have to remember that the so-called person in power does not refer to the monarch, king, or judge. None of these. It is any individual, a family, a group such as a Buddhist group, a company, a village, a city, or a country. They must have decision makers to decide some business. You personally also need to decide your own behavior and decide to go to the left or the right. All in all, a decision maker is called a person in power. This decision maker must bear the 2/7 of the good or bad fruition retribution. If you are an individual, 5/7 is for you, 2/7 is also for you because you are the decision maker yourself. If you listen to someone else's instigation, which causes you to decide something, then that person is indirectly a decision maker because that person helps you make decisions. If you have any mistakes in this matter, those who help you make decisions will bear 2/7 of the fruition retribution. This is how the calculation works. The calculation method of the law of cause and effect that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said is what we just said. Let us take a closer look and see how it is calculated. Those in power are the decision makers. The person in power, at that time, was the jury of the district court. Later, the jury voluntarily gave up the power and transferred it to the presiding judge of the district court. The presiding judge was very clever and immediately transferred the power to the presiding judge of the high court. The presiding judge of the high court was also very clever and immediately transferred the power to Queen Victoria. But by law, Queen Victoria did not take care of these matters and transferred the power to the Home Secretary. The Home Secretary was also very smart. He went to ask the Attorney General and the Deputy Attorney General. Can you see this association diagram? In fact, you will see the final decision. The murderer had already been sentenced to death, but in the end, he did not have to die. It turned out that the Home Secretary was the official decision maker. As he needed the permission of the Queen of England, therefore, the Queen of England had also participated, and the Attorney General and the Deputy Attorney General had given their views, therefore, they were involved also. Let us see who else were involved. In fact, who had made the Queen Victoria and the Home Secretary feeling so difficult, to think so hard, how to make a verdict? Should it be sentenced to death or a life imprisonment or a lighter sentence? The reason they worked so hard was because of collective karma. At that time, the crowd was surging. That was, those people were involved and thus leading to the current situation. It was because of these people, there was no way to take the proper path, to make the right judgment, and to do the right thing. The most important thing was these people, the collective karma. That is, you will see all the decision makers, those people in power. Who is the final person in power? It turns out that it can be constantly changing. It is constantly changing with the karma. For example, if you are the head of the family, you are abetted by the neighbors, your decision will be changed. Beating a child with a rattan stick to beat your child can be changed from 5 to 10 slaps. It turns out that real decision makers can constantly change. Let us have a look now. Collective karma is group sentiment surging, which is the main cause of light judgment. The resentment of the slain and the fruition retribution of the killing karma, how are these fruition retributions distributed? According to the equation of the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, how is it distributed? It turns out that this crowd of people will bear 2/7 of the fruition retribution. A problem arises. Does every person bear 2/7? Or 2/7 of the fruition retribution is shared among this group of people? If you have listened to me saying to determine cause and effect with the mind nature and also know how the laws of nature work and how to reincarnate, you will know how to calculate this problem. And you will also understand how to calculate with the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's equation. It depends on how evil an individual's mind nature is. It is calculated on a per-person base. If you are a person with unclear thoughts, or someone who does not know the difference between right and wrong, you will think in your heart, but you do not know whether the judge is right, or the public's opinion is right. I sometimes feel that this side is right, but sometimes I feel that side is right. I cannot tell the difference. In fact, I have not said that he must be sentenced to death, or he must be pardoned. I will agree if there is no need for people to die. Amnesty is a good practice. Then, you are a member of the masses. In this case, which category do you belong to? You belong to the type with even distribution. That is, a group of people must bear 2/7 of the fruition retribution together, and you are among them. It will be diluted because your mind nature is not so strongly paranoid. If you belong to those diehards, and if there is a riot, you will be the first one to demolish the courthouse and put a bomb to destroy the judge's home, you will support it definitely. There is no reason for making a death sentence. Many people kill like that. To kill one and save many, it is fine. An amnesty is certainly necessary. If there is no amnesty, you will come out and riot. If you are this type, you have to bear 2/7 of the fruition retribution alone. So, if you want to be a mediator, remember, as I said before, why some people will get into trouble. For example, someone is being possessed by a ghost, and another person is being asked by a third party, or his family, to help out. If this person uses a tough approach to drive away that ghost, instead of explaining the truth, so that everyone's mind nature is balanced. That is, he used some spells, no matter what type of spells, to drive away that ghost, so that the ghost would not to entangle this person. On the surface, this is a virtuous act. Because someone asks you to help him and you help him without pay. But you have to understand that when you do one thing, it is not just about your right or wrong. It is not that simple. Another example is that for the sake of preventing social unrest and riots, so as not to cause casualties, so this is done. It is not that simple. You also have to worry about the elevation and descent of their mind nature. Because you have not taken care of the ghost's mind nature, and you have not treated it at the truth-telling level. You just use a tough approach to drive it away, and to save that person. That is, you are partial and paranoid to one side. Just now the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni also talked about what is a king of Dharma. The king of Dharma is selfless, has no partiality to any one side, has no partisan or faction. And now you have a partisan. Because this person is your friend and he has asked you to save his son. His son is bewitched by a ghost, and you don't care what is the ghost's grace and resentment. In short, this ghost is nasty because it is harassing him. Thus, you drive it away, kill it, punish it, or trap it. Then your most vicious heart will appear. When you drive away a person, you will have a vicious heart, and you will set a ploy to drive him away. This will cause problems. Therefore, some people later discover whether they have acted as a peacemaker for others, and now it is their turn to be harassed by the ghosts. So, he came to ask me if he has become like this because he has acted as a peacemaker? I would answer, yes. Why? Because if a person gets into trouble, there must be karma, and there must be the cause and effect association diagram. That association diagram may be very strong, one layer connected with another, and may have connected with countless past lifetimes. And you cannot see anything, you only see the first layer. Your friend asks you to save his son, so you just see one association diagram. You want to make a virtuous deed, you are a Dharma practitioner, now you know methods and Dharma rituals, you are going to practice Dharma rituals to help his son, so you go and do it. You have only looked at one level of things. This will cause problems. So, we would say that to be peacemakers, this is something cannot be done. Acting as a peacemaker means that you are a member of this cause and effect association diagram. Just like the chart just now, going down from one layer to another layer, and to the last, the Attorney General and the Deputy Attorney General also have a share. They just give some opinion, explain a little bit. It turns out that expressing opinions will also affect the mind nature of others. Because your opinion affects others' mind nature and affects his decision, in fact, you have become one-third or more of the decision maker. That is, you have entered and become part of this association diagram, just a matter of being heavier or lighter. The Queen of England does not listen to what you said, not the Attorney General, but the decision-maker and the Home Secretary's words. She has entered the association diagram also. This way, whenever someone asks you for your opinion, whenever someone asks for your help, then will you actually help or not? Someone asked me, said, somebody asked me to lend him money. Should I lend him or not? The guru is to teach the Buddhist holy dharma, not to teach the people whether to lend money or not. I am just teaching you a great truth for going ahead. I don't know how to teach such subtle things. I don't know what is your relationship with his association diagrams. This is because if I tell you the answer, I have to observe a lot of things. I have to read through all the association diagrams before I can answer you. As I am so busy, how can I help you view these association diagrams? So, I won't go and see it, but will only give you a general answer. So, you have to remember, don't say help him or guide him so quickly. You should ask clearly why this incident happened and its ins and outs. Therefore, if someone asks me, asks for help, saying that someone is harassed by ghosts, I will tell him, the ghost will definitely scold him, even if it doesn't, he will talk to himself. Can you tell me what the ghost said and what he said to himself? Can you tell me that dialogue? So, if you become a guru in the future, or when someone asks you to help, you have to remember one thing, don't give the answer so quickly. The most important thing is to ask the ins and outs. If someone is bewitched by ghosts, you have to ask him, what did he say when he was talking to himself? That paragraph of speech is extremely important. That paragraph of speech belongs to the association diagram. That is to say, you have to know the association diagram. To know the association diagram, you have no reason to investigate his background, understand all his things, and then go back and practice rituals for others. As so, you stop your own dharma practice, stop the practice for liberation of the cycle of karmic reincarnations. But just care about entering meditative concentration to view others' association diagrams. You have no reasons to do this, right? How to understand the association diagrams in the quickest way? That is to ask him what the ghost words are when he talks to himself. Then, you will know what type of killing this is. Is it a vendetta that must take away his life, or just an ordinary hatred? What is the level of hatred? What sort of hatred? The hatred for killing? The hatred for money debt? Is it a blood debt or money debt? These are all very important. Blood debts, you must not touch. Blood debt is very serious, you should not touch. Now these are blood debts, drinking his blood, eating his flesh, these are blood debts. You do not make decisions indiscriminately. So, you have to remember that when you act as a peacemaker, you will become part of the association diagram. You will be the same as what the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said. Just like being a king, if someone in his country has committed a crime, the king will be related, although the things happen far away from him, he will still be related. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni tells you the truth of nature, which is not fictional. This formula is not made up by him too. Just because the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni is omniscient, that is, he knows everything, so he tells everyone. It is not fictitious, the nature operates in this way. Now, let me tell you, don't touch blood debts carelessly. You need to admit that you cannot do anything, or you can only teach him some ways to resolve this piece of hatred, this is feasible. If you teach him to deal with the ghost, then you have to be careful. Because the expulsion is relatively ruthless, you will use your cruel heart or cruel methods, and so, your ruthless heart will appear. However, if you use a balanced mind, talk about reasons to resolve this part of the hatred, tell the ghost some Buddhist holy dharma and teach some Buddhist holy dharma to the people. Balance the mind nature of the two, softening the toughness, this is feasible. You, as a peacemaker, can only do up to this position. Remember, you can only do this up to this position. Do not do it to a greater extent. You have not reached these levels. Here too, this is a case of acting as a peacemaker. Therefore, to be a peacemaker, one has to look at the mentality of the peacemaker to decide whether 2/7 of the fruition retribution to be received alone or to be shared evenly. This is the mind nature determines the cause and effect. That is, the motive of your mind at that time is decisive. So, you need to be careful. Now, let's look clearly at it again. It is very important that we use wisdom to develop some foundations for mind training. The foundation of mind training must be built on a kind of judgment and standard of practice related to mind training. What I just taught you is a standard of doing things. That is, you definitely have the opportunity to be asked about your opinion, be asked to help, be asked to lend money, be asked by others to be involved in certain matters. Among all the above things, in addition to your benevolence to help him, or you owe that person a debt of gratitude and thus you have to help him, you have to calculate one more thing. That is to understand the association diagram. Second, you need to understand from this incident, after doing it, does your mind nature elevate or descend or keep balanced? So, you have to know, what the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said is not just a king's cause and effect association diagram, but this formula is applicable to all daily life, all people and things. It is necessary for us to establish the standard of judgment and practice. It must be applicable to all daily life. It conforms to the standards of the precepts and contains wisdom. It can integrate the relative truth and the absolute truth. What is relative truth? That is, in our world, what we call the law of cause and effect. What is absolute truth? That is, emptiness. Just as said in the Heart Sutra, everything is empty. Many of you are often confused. People always think that everything is empty is to put down our attachments, and as a result, it becomes denying the cause and effect, which is a bad thing. In our Buddhist Dharma, the absolute truth refers to emptiness and applies to the Dharma realm. But in fact, we are now in the three realms and we are not able to enter the Dharma realm. When you can enter, it means you can become a Buddha. If you have not entered the Dharma realm, but you are talking about the laws of operation in the Dharma realm, it is actually very silly. It is equivalent to that you are in Hong Kong, you should talk about the laws of Hong Kong. But you keep saying that if you commit this incident, it will not be a problem in the United States, there is no reason to have problems here. So, you go ahead to do it, then you will be subject to the laws of Hong Kong and will be punished. You are still talking about the incidents far away, saying that nothing like this in the United States. That is to say, you are in the three realms, but often say that there is nothing in the Dharma realm. Everything is empty in the Dharma realm. You think that all are not existed. Then, a lot of people, because of this, deny the cause and effect. This is wrong. Therefore, in fact, how to take this cause and effect and Dharma realm, that is the relative truth and the absolute truth, to shorten the distance of the two. This will be explained in the future. All the time, what I have been explaining is about the law of cause and effect. That is the said equation by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni on how to calculate the cause and effect, whether you are in the association diagrams. This is what we are talking about now. So, in fact, we still have to know that in our three realms, where does the cause and effect come from? It is the mind nature determines the cause and effect, which has been explained in the first lecture of mind training episode. That is the 16th lecture of the essence of the Dharma practice of Tibetan Buddhism. And in the second lecture of Mind Training episode, that is the 17th lecture of the essence of the Dharma practice of Tibetan Buddhism. It has explained the use of elevation and descent of mind nature to determine right and wrong. Although you know what is right and what is wrong, but when you execute this matter, you still have to learn more. So, I will teach you one more thing. In the third lecture of Mind Training episode, which is the 18th lecture of the essence of the Dharma practice of Tibetan Buddhism, I have said that this criterion overrides all worldly rules. That is to say, this criterion of using the mind nature to determine the right and wrong and using its elevation and descent to determine right and wrong is placed above all the worldly rules, including egalitarianism, principlism, and all of liberalism. It is above all these. However, just this alone is not enough for you to make a judgment. So, I asked you to raise your hands to decide how to make the verdict, whether to sentence him to death or to sentence him lightly. Do you use principlism or utilitarianism, or you use the Buddhist Holy Dharma, and you are not clear about what kind of doctrine you are, you find that you will raise your hand. You may say, because I don't know you have a third answer, otherwise, I may choose to raise my hand for the third answer. In this way, this is not your own original idea, you just make a choice after seeing it. You should use the principle that you have always used. You use the same principle to see what kind of doctrine you are, and then you make the changes. We have to make changes, and do all in accordance with the rules of the Buddhist Holy Dharma. The principle of the Buddhist Holy Dharma, in fact, the most important thing, is to ask for one extra thing, that is wisdom. We need to balance some things with wisdom. But when balancing, when you use this thing, you still need to be careful. If that incident is wrong, and makes the mind nature to descend, it cannot be used to balance. Moreover, I want to tell you the second thing. Even though you are right, assuming that you have done the right thing with the principle of the Buddhist Holy Dharma, just as I have said before that all those judges are right, the four things are right also. They are right to conceal the facts and to guide others to the wrong side. The correct sentence is also right. Giving the recommendation for mercy to avoid the downfall of mind nature of the modern people, this is also right. All the four things are right. But I also said before, they still have the cause and effect. That is to say, that group of judges and the prosecutors who give advices to others, and even all the people in the entire association diagrams, including those crowds, all will have cause and effect. But how to calculate it? It depends on their own mind nature. And have you noticed that the judges are very kind? They have ethical standards, virtuous thoughts, stratagems, fond of thinking, all of which I have said just now. I can tell you that if they are reborn, they will definitely go to the three virtuous paths. And the three virtuous paths are also differentiate into general and good or better. It turns out that there are actually some causes and effects pulling them behind. The slain is sent to death in vain, and his blood is drunk in vain, because the murderer is not punished severely and the light judgment is made by the judges. For this cause and effect, how much do they have to bear? It is 2/7. But is this 2/7 evenly shared among the group of judges, or how will it be? I can tell you that it is evenly shared among the entire group of judges. Why? It is because of all their mind nature is virtuous. They do not have any one bad motive, their mind nature is good. And they have made the recommendation for mercy. They pity the murdered and pity the murderer. You can see that they are not biased. So, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had said before, what is a king of Dharma? If there is no bias, no partiality, and no partisan, it will be called a king of Dharma. So, they can also be called king of Dharma. they implement some laws correctly, then they will be called King of Dharma. Therefore, all the people in the association diagram, except those masses, the protagonists, the persons in power, will share 2/7 of the fruition retribution. However, those masses, according to their own mind nature, some may bear the complete 2/7, and some may share 2/7 evenly. This is what I want to teach you today. That is, when you use the Buddhist holy dharma to judge whether something is right or wrong, to do it or not to do it, you use these criterions to make judgments. But you have to remember that whatever you do right or wrong, you will have fruition retributions. Don't misunderstand one thing and say, "Guru, you teach me, if it makes an elevation of mind nature, it is right. Now I have done it right, why do I still have fruition retribution?" I will tell you now, the fruition retribution is there forever, because the law of cause and effect is definitely there in the three realms. The difference lies on evil and half virtuous, or just virtuous? It depends on how much virtues and evils are in that combination. And how much evils and virtues are there actually? How to calculate this? Today, I have taught you already. So, I taught you a few things today. First, how to apply that equation. Second, in the Buddhist holy dharma criterions, one more thing is to be added necessarily, it is called balance, that is wisdom. In the six paramithas, wisdom is very important. So, in the Buddhist holy dharma criterions, it is necessary to have wisdom. Third, I have taught you that cause and effect is there certainly. Do not deny the cause and effect. If you do something correctly, there will be cause and effect also. It cannot be avoided completely. Why would you, for no reason, act as that judge to make a verdict for the case? Why would the person next door, for no reasons, not ask someone else, but ask you? It is because of your previous lifetime's association diagrams that you are already a part of it. So, you live next to him, and he will come and ask you, and you will be forced to promise or not to promise him. That is to say, there is already a connection between all causes and effects. Today, how you use the Buddhist holy dharma to correct that incident, to correct your mistakes committed in numerous lifetimes, is the most important thing. Therefore, Dharma practitioners must know how to distinguish right and wrong, how to deal with them, and understand clearly all causes and effects. This is a very important thing we Dharma practitioners must do. This is more important than all the visualizations. To teach you any skills, you may not be able to escape, but to understand these, you can escape. You can certainly slowly go up and can escape. Although you do not understand any of the visualizations, as long as you understand these, you can certainly elevate upwards. And you will certainly be able to get out of the cycle of karmic reincarnation in the future. But if you do not understand these, no matter how you visualize, practice on altar rituals, you will fail. It will not work regardless. It cannot fight against karma. These are the things I teach you for the fourth lecture of today. We stop here today. Let us review the previous lectures. Our first lecture on essence on the Dharma practice of Tibetan Buddhism, it talks, can you ensure that your Dharma practice is useful and works? The second lecture, what is the relationship between your destiny and Sahadeva? The third lecture, how to avoid the post-death trial and the abstruseness of the Pure Land. The fourth lecture, the method in figuring out the future destiny. The fifth lecture, the high degree of risks and danger in the post-death world. The sixth lecture, the characteristic tendency in karmic retributions, how it affects the destiny. The seventh lecture, how to make the spirits of the deceased to let go their attachment to greed. The eighth lecture, the impact of one's attachment to anger and hatred in afterlife. The ninth lecture, the frequently encountered problems on being trapped after death. The tenth lecture, after death dangers triggered by ignorance. The 11th lecture, what dangers would be encountered as it is proved that life continue to exist after death. The 12th lecture, why we need to gain the mind's dominance in the spiritual realm. The 13th lecture, what are the disintegration parts in the post-death world? The 14th lecture, what are the dangers of non-religious spiritual training practices? The 15th lecture, the relationship of danger, opportunity, and mind nature in Dharma practice. The 16th lecture, that is mind training, episode 1. How to use wisdom to formulate the basis of mind training. The 17th lecture, that is mind training, episode 2. How to balance the right and wrong in the gray areas. The 18th lecture, that is mind training, episode 3. What is the principle of judging right and wrong in Buddhist Dharma? The 19th lecture, that is today's lecture, mind training, episode 4. The importance of the mind-nature balance. Well, now let us invite Vajra Master to lead us to recite the prayers.
Well, will all the Dharma friends please follow me to recite the prayer to eliminate plague? All actions are impermanence and sufferings. Serious plagues suddenly spread. We should practice the Buddhist holy Dharma to eliminate the negative karmas. Pray to all Buddhas in helping to eliminate all plagues. All sufferings of collective karmas are being aroused by hatred. While hatred has evolved from greed and ignorance, the three poisons are intertwining to develop into plagues. We sincerely repent for all of our misdeeds and faults. Completely repentance of sins, misdeeds, and faults for the breaking of precepts and of vows. Hereby and from now on we sincerely make our vows to strictly keep the 10 precepts and to uphold the correct holy Dharma. In studying the sutras so as to reveal our own wisdom. In understanding the correct Buddhist view and action of the right path. In realizing and entering into the ocean of the holy Dharma in order to unveil the true nature of oneself. Buddhahood. To prostrate wholeheartedly, with devotion, at the lotus feet of all Buddhas. Pray to bestow the nectars of the holy Dharma as rainfalls. Eliminating all plagues and pathological changes. Eliminating greed, with the cease of hatred and the rid of ignorance. Blessing the world with health, fortune, and joy. Sentient beings can become virtuous so that the collective karmas could be changed. Gurus, all Buddhas, and Bodhisattvas, together with the Uttams, Dakas, and Dakinis, and numerous Dharma protectors, as limitless as the ocean, united with numerous virtuous Devas. Please remember the auspicious vows that all of you have made in the past eons. Have compassion and mercy to accept all our repentances. Think fondly of all sentient beings as your children. Forgive all these faults and grant protection and support. Lead the dead to the pure land of great bliss. Earnestly support and maintain those patients for their swift recovery. We all take our vows to practice the correct holy Dharma. Kindly eliminate all plagues in an instant. Such that this world will never hear the words of war, illness, and suffering. But only listen to the gentle voice of the holy Dharma and the holy names of all Buddhas. The three realms would have great fortune, together with ever-increasing virtues and auspiciousness. Entire Dudjom Buddhist Association. We are here praying for the peace of world sincerely. We are praying for all motherly sentient beings to eliminate diseases. Finally, can escape from suffering and attain happiness. Have an early proof in enlightenment. Wish there is an increase in fine virtuous wonders. Finally, we do an overall transfer merit. Transfer merit to all the victims. Wishing all those surpassing powers of Dharma practice. Generate countless and boundless auspicious merits and virtues. The dedication of all merits to all sentient beings. Wishing them all to be reborn in the pure Buddha land. Wishing merits and virtues from Dharma preaching and Dharma practice, all be dedicated to. Earthquake in Yunnan, Gizhou borders, tornado and flooding in Beijing, flooding in eastern USA, earthquake in Xinjiang, flooding in several provinces in southern China. Earthquake in Sichuan and the border of Yunnan, tornado in Colombia, flooding in Cuba, earthquake in Italy, drought in Mali and Niger, earthquake in Indonesia, Java, earthquake in Mexico. Disaster caused by strong winds and floods in Australia, disaster caused by strong winds and floods in Philippines, conflagration in the stalls of Fayoun Street, Kowloon, earthquake in Turkey. Flooding in Thailand, high-speed rail accident in Wenzhou, flooding and mud rock flow in Sichuan province, flooding in Hunan, Hubei, and Jiangxi provinces, flooding and tornado in Guangdong. Tornado in USA, earthquake and tsunami in Indonesia, Java, earthquake in Greece, flooding and mud rock flow in Colombia, earthquake in China-Burma-Thai border, earthquake. Tsunami and nuclear disaster in Japan, earthquake in New Zealand, hostage-taking incident in Philippines, mud rock flow in Gansu province, flooding in Pakistan, earthquake in Qinghai. Earthquake in Chile, earthquake in Haiti, earthquake in Sichuan, earthquake and tsunami in Indonesia, strong winds and floods in Taiwan, snowstorm in Hunan, windstorm in Burma. All sentient beings who died in these disasters, and all the painful sentient beings who suffer from other disasters such as war, unrest, and plague. Wishing they soon get away and free from the pain of the three cataclysms and eight disasters. And they take refuge from the three treasures. They enjoy the comfort and happiness eternally and be able to be born in front of the Buddha. And wishing all the victims can go to the western land of extreme bliss soonest and make landing at the other shore. Wishing that all disasters will cease, all sentient beings can practice Buddhist Dharma. The yoga force falls upon me to make causes and undertakings succeed. For all sentient beings left none. All reaching Udom land in the end. Auspiciousness in days and nights. Auspiciousness great with Grand Master's blessings. Auspiciousness forever for every yogin. Auspiciousness for all sentient beings. Wish there is an increase in fine virtuous wonders.